I published a piece recently in the King's Law Journal. I was asked in June to publish a piece that should be submitted in September for publication in December about Scotland's place in the EU. And every time I finished a draft of that paper, a major announcement occurred. The UK government ruled out this option. There was another redraft. The Scottish government ruled in this option. There was another redraft. And I thought, accepting this invitation, at least there's been tranquility and some certainty. I know what I'm going to talk about. Until 11 o'clock last night, when the First Minister called a press conference that is currently ongoing and which seems to be changing the game once again. Now, I'm just going to start with some very, very brief remarks. I don't have a full handle on what's happening at the First Minister's press conference because it is literally happening right now. Typical of Nicola Sturgeon to steal my thunder. But there are a few comments that I think we can make. What we do know is that, according to the First Minister, her attempts to seek compromise with the UK government, that's to say a differentiated relationship with the EU for Scotland, as well as perhaps for Northern Ireland and maybe even for Wales, where at least in Scotland and Northern Ireland's case, there were votes, significant majorities to remain in the EU, that those attempts to find a differentiated solution have failed. She said today that the UK government have not moved an inch, and so she has announced that within the next week she will begin the steps necessary to give the Scottish people a choice between a hard Brexit and an independence referendum. So it looks like the second independence referendum has all but been called. Now, I hadn't really planned to address this directly in the talk, but I'll just start with three comments. You'll notice that as I go through this, all of my comments happen to be reducible to three. I'm not quite sure why that is. But I'll start with three comments that signpost some issues that might arise as a result of the calling of a second referendum, or the, it seems, almost inevitable calling of a second referendum. The first is the question of legislative competence. As I'll talk about in a wee bit more detail during the talk proper, the Scottish Parliament is a parliament of bounded competence. Unlike Westminster, there are laws which it cannot make or unmake, and those laws, those boundaries, are policed by the courts. One of the boundaries to competence is that the Constitution and the Union of Scotland and England is a reserved matter. That's to say that the Scottish Parliament cannot legislate in a way that relates to the union between Scotland and England. Now, it remains a matter of debate whether or not an independence referendum itself is a matter which relates to the union between Scotland and England and can therefore be struck down by the courts, would therefore be overruled by the courts. I think the preponderance of opinion is that if you take into account the object and purposes and the likely effects of an independence referendum, that this is not merely an opinion poll but is a means of making a decision, then it is likely the law would come down on the side of the object and purpose of a referendum being one that relates to the union between Scotland and England, and therefore being one that's beyond the powers of the Scottish Parliament. But I just wanted to flag up for what I think is a significant reason why that seed of doubt remains. There is a seed of doubt that has support in academic opinion, and I can make you aware of what that is. I'll perhaps send an email with some notes around following this event. But there is some academic opinion that says that that an independence referendum is a means of testing public opinion. It's a means of indicating to the Scottish government whether or not to pursue independence. That, for example, if there is a clear no vote in the referendum, then it will not have the effect of breaking up the union, and therefore it will not relate to that, and there is perhaps some room to doubt whether or not it's within competence. Now, the reason why I just flag up this seed of doubt is that although it seems likely, going by the First Minister's statements, that what she will seek is a Section 30 order, a transfer of legislative competence from Westminster to the Scottish Parliament, as was practiced during the 2014 referendum, to put the legal question beyond doubt, to make sure that it doesn't end up in the Supreme Court, there does remain that question: what happens if the UK government says no? Or what happens if the UK government attempts to dictate the terms of an independence referendum in a way that seems to be disadvantageous to the Scottish Government, or maybe even to the Scottish people by delaying it to well beyond Brexit, for example. You can have your referendum, but not until these negotiations are concluded, not until you are on the outside. In that case, the very fact that there is a seed of doubt, there is room for argument as to whether the Scottish Parliament has legislative competence, whether the Scottish Government can introduce this legislation, becomes significant at the political level. Maybe not at the legal level, not at the level of what might happen in a courtroom, but at a political level. Because if you can make the argument that you have the competence to do this, then you put the ball in the UK government's court. That if we introduce this legislation, dare the UK government to veto the referendum, dare the UK government to refer the case to the UK Supreme Court and to have the UK Supreme Court tell the Scottish Parliament that it doesn't have the power to act, and therefore to create what is in effect a political win-win, that either the Scottish Government has its referendum, as it intends to have, or it has a clear statement from the UK institutions that it does not have such power and can make political capital out of that. So the competence question hasn't quite been addressed by the fact of a Section 30 order in the previous referendum, and it might be an issue that arises if the UK Government plays hardball with it. The second question is what a differentiated response might require. The First Minister has said that although it seems unlikely, she is open to further negotiation, and it seems possible that an independence referendum will be taken back off the table if a differentiated response to Brexit can be found for Scotland. That is to say, for example, that Scotland remains within the single market. Well, that, it seems to me, would have significant impact on devolution. In order for Scotland to retain a relationship with the European Union, you would need a significant further devolution of powers. We've already had significant devolution of powers, tax raising powers, in the Scotland Act 2012, after the review of the Calman Commission. A couple of years later, we had a significant review of powers in the Smith Commission and transfer of more powers. And here we are, not even a year after the Scotland Act 2016, with cause to further review the division of competence between the Scottish Parliament and the UK Parliament, insofar as it might require the devolution of even more powers to allow Scotland to remain in the EU, or to have a relationship with the EU. That might include powers to sign international treaties. That might include powers of or competences around immigration to allow for the free movement that might be required for that. It might mean the competence of further competence in relation to employment laws or regulations to ensure that free movement can be utilised to its fullest effects. The point is simply that the issue of more devolution is not off the table just because the Smith Commission and the Calman Commission seemed to have settled the question for some time in 2012 and in 2016. And then finally, the third point, as I said, in a very tentative response to what I think the First Minister is saying right now, is that she gave a speech recently, maybe a few weeks ago, in which she was criticised, the First Minister was criticised a bit, A, for suggesting in the draft of the speech that was circulated that Brexit posed a threat to devolution itself, and B, for deciding to skip that passage when she actually delivered that speech, and that's something that journalists picked up on at the time. She was criticised in this old line of grievance mongering, for example, that this is an attempt to build a grievance with the UK and therefore to build or to construct a route to independence. But I think there is, to a certain extent, space to see Brexit as a threat, if not to devolution itself, if not to the fact of devolution, at least to the assumptions that underpin devolution. And again, this is a very tentative response to something that I think she might be saying. But I would just say that we can take a wee bit more seriously than it has been the idea that Brexit poses a threat to the underlying assumptions of devolution. Which is notable, which was brought to my mind yesterday when Nigel Farage suggested that the UK, that the talk in Brussels is that the UK might be willing to give away access to fishing to British waters in order to put a chip on the table in order to win concessions from the EU in the Article 50 negotiations. But of course, the fishing rights currently exercised at the EU level are not matters reserved to Westminster. We have a conferred powers of, a retaining model of devolution, which is to say that everything is devolved unless it is expressly reserved in the Scotland Act. Fishing, along with some other EU competences, environmental law and protection and regulation, as well as agriculture, are not, these areas are not specifically reserved in Schedule 5 of the Scotland Act, and therefore the starting assumption must be that following a retaining model of devolution, they return, they're repatriated to the Scottish Parliament, and any negotiation to return them to the UK begins with that assumption. The UK seems to be taking a slightly different approach, that we never intended for Brexit to exist when we drafted the Scotland Act, and so the facts have changed and the law has to change with it. But it fundamentally changes the devolution settlement, because it assumes a conferred powers model in these areas, i.e. that you will only have devolution over these areas if it is specifically granted. That is a threat to devolution, I think, because it changes the assumptions under which it works. And I suppose the final point on that is that if the Scottish Government was able to persuade the UK that the retaining model of devolution does mean, whether they intended it in 1998 or not, does mean that these are areas that are devolved to the Scottish Parliament, that in order to return them to the UK level, that would require a process of negotiation that would mean opening up the Scotland Act, opening up Schedule 5, opening up the list of reserved matters and amending it. That would be something that would engage the Sewell Convention, that would require the consent of the Scottish Parliament, and therefore at that point the Scottish Government has some leverage to use the withholding of consent in order to influence the behaviour and approach of the Scottish Government. So those are just some very, very, very tentative comments that I don't intend to cover, or I hadn't intended to cover until the First Minister got in the way. What I'm going to suggest is, I'm going to make four broad bullet points, I suppose, which will more or less loosely hang together, about the way in which the human rights and Scotland's constitutional position interacts. Unlike Clare, I'm not, strictly speaking, an equalities or human rights lawyer, and so I'm going to give this more of a constitutional glint, I suppose, and I'll defer to some other experts in the room on the technicalities of human rights and equalities law. But the first bullet point, or the first heading that I want to suggest, is that devolution was intended to create a parliament that was qualitatively different from Westminster. Devolution was intended to create a parliament that is qualitatively different from Westminster. This was a thread that ran through the claim of right for Scotland, that ran through the Scottish Constitutional Convention, that ran through the consultative steering group that drew up the framework for devolution, that ran through the Scotland Act 1998 itself. The Scottish Parliament would be, to replicate the, or to parrot the founding principles established by the consultative steering group, the Scottish Parliament would be more accountable than the Westminster Parliament. It would be more open and transparent than the Westminster Parliament. It would provide more opportunities for women and minorities, and it would share power more widely, both between the executive and the Parliament, and between the Parliament and wider civil society. Now, you can decide for yourself whether or not the early years of devolution, the first 17 or so years of devolution, has seen those aims to be realised, and in fact the presiding officer has commissioned a commission on parliamentary reform that will gauge the Parliament's performance in relation to those founding principles that will report in June. But one of the significant differences that has had an impact is that the Scottish Parliament, as I said, is a Parliament of limited competence. It's a Parliament of bounded competence. Now, where Westminster is free to make or unmake any law whatsoever, or at least the orthodox reading of the British Constitution is that Westminster is free to make or unmake any law whatsoever, and where acts of Parliament are free from, immune from judicial censure, no court can set aside an act of Parliament. As I said, in the Scottish context, there are laws which the Scottish Parliament cannot make or unmake, and acts of the Scottish Parliament that go beyond those limits can be struck down by the courts. This is an extremely powerful constraint on what the Parliament and the government can do. Now, this is not only because the Scotland Act, the Scottish Parliament, is itself a creature of statute, a subordinate legislature created by an act of Parliament at Westminster. This was also an aspiration. Bernard Crick and David Miller, at the time of the Scottish Constitutional Convention and anticipating the work of the Consultative Steering Group, said that it would help to make the Scottish Parliament a model of democracy if the laws that it made were subject to judicial review in the courts, if the legislative freedom of the Parliament was subject to limits, including limits in relation to human rights. So an Act of Scottish Parliament, then, is not law. The Scotland Act tells us an Act of the Scottish Parliament is not law to the extent that it relates to a reserved matter, that's policy areas that are retained at Westminster, that it's incompatible with a convention right, or that it's incompatible with EU law. And the Scotland Act replicates those limits for the Scottish Government as well as for the Scottish Parliament. Now, the significance of this for the model of rights protection in the Scotland Act model is twofold. First of all, devolution has created powers for the judiciary. And the first significance is that devolution has created powers for the judiciary that have hitherto been unknown to the British Constitution to strike down primary legislation enacted by a democratically elected legislature. Devolution has created new powers for the judiciary to strike down legislation enacted by a democratically elected legislature. Whether those are conferred by the European Convention on Human Rights or contained in the various sources of EU law, the EU treaties, the jurisprudence of the Court of Justice for the European Union, or the Charter for Fundamental Rights that Clare has introduced in her talk. If, for example, to highlight the significance of this, if, for example, the Scottish Parliament sought to use its new powers to amend the franchise in a way that replicated the ban on the right of prisoners to vote, this would not only be subject to a declaration of incompatibility, the courts would not merely ask Parliament to think again about the propriety of that ban, this would be struck down by the courts as such, as a violation of convention rights of Article 3, Protocol 1, and the right to participate in free and fair elections. So the stakes are high. And the stakes are high not only because the Scottish the courts have these powers in relation to the Parliament, but because as more and more powers are transferred to the Scottish Parliament, more and more powers are transferred from a system which is immune from strong judicial review, from strike down, to a system where the attitude of the courts and the possibility of judicial strike down has to be taken into account. The transfer of the powers of competence over abortion, for example, leads to thorny issues when the government begins to legislate, because it seems that in that area some sort of judicial challenge would be inevitable. Now, thus far, there have been about more than a dozen, I think about 14 or 15 challenges to Acts of the Scottish Parliament, three of which in relation to agricultural holdings, the imposition of bail conditions, and the named person scheme have been successful, albeit to a limited extent, on human rights grounds. But it's also worth noting, and I don't want to stress this point too much, but it is worth noting that it's not only the powerless who assert arguments from rights against the state, who avail themselves of rights protections in the face of supposedly incompatible legislation. So, for example, defeats for Acts of General Insurance against the requirement to make payments where employers have negligently exposed employees to asbestos exposure, defeats for Imperial Tobacco in relation to the display of tobacco products at the point of sale, or, as it stands, defeat for the Scottish Whisky Association in relation to the policy of minimum unit alcohol pricing. These defeats might nevertheless be seen as strategic victories where legislation affecting the commercial interests of these bodies is delayed by their ability to challenge that legislation through the courts, to delay by 5 years or so the implementation of legislation that would otherwise negatively affect in that time their commercial interests. And I'll say a little bit more about that in a moment. The second significance of the bounded competence is less about the judicial and more about the legal process. In common with the Human Rights Act, as well as innovations in other jurisdictions, notably in Canada and in New Zealand, the Scotland Act does not defer questions about rights compatibility to the relatively few cases which reach the courts. At the beginning of the Scottish legislative process, the Scottish minister responsible for a government bill and the presiding officer speaking on behalf of the Parliament are required to vet legislation to determine whether or not it is within, at the moment of introduction, whether or not it is within the powers of the Parliament. Every bill is considered for its compatibility with EU law and with convention rights. And at the end of the process, the Lord Advocate on behalf of the Scottish Government and the Advocate General on behalf of the UK Government may refer bills directly to the UK Supreme Court to test a question of competence, to test the boundaries of competence before the bill is submitted for royal assent. Now, thus far, there have been no occasions in which a minister, the presiding officer, have said that a bill is out with the competence of the Parliament, is incompatible with EU law or with convention rights, and there have been no situations in which the Supreme Court has been asked to review an act of the Scottish Parliament before royal assent. But neither of those outcomes are inevitable. In Wales, for example, three bills have been referred directly to the Supreme Court before royal assent. And again, I just want to make three points about this, the third of which brings us back squarely to today's topic, which is Brexit, in case you're wondering where Brexit is in all of this. First of all, the Scotland Act and these other mechanisms, the Human Rights Act is one, and as I said, rights protection in New Zealand and Canada, demand of us to think differently, to think politically about rights by engaging Scottish ministers and members of the Scottish Parliament in questions about compatibility, in order to assert to the Parliament that legislation is within the competence of the Parliament, the Scottish ministers will have to take legal advice on that question. The Parliament, the presiding officer on behalf of Parliament, will take legal advice on those questions. And so that when a bill is introduced where compatibility issues are raised, the ministers and the Parliament should be better informed about the issues that might arise and the threat to legislation that might exist at the end post-royal assent. So far, however, and I think this is true in all of the jurisdictions that have attempted to find this model, a balance between strong judicial protection for right or meaningful protection of human rights and a strong role for the legislature, a strong role for Parliament. So far, we haven't yet got to the stage where we think differently, where we think politically about rights, where rights is not just a question about what is the bare minimum that we have to do to avoid defeat in the Supreme Court, but where we can think more expansively, more purposively, more boldly about what positive human rights might entail. Thus far, and this is in research that I hope to publish in September based on interviews with government, UK government and Parliament lawyers, thus far the message is that political actors, MSPs, ministers and the presiding officer will largely defer to the legal assessments that are offered to them by government lawyers or by Parliament lawyers. That's to say, they will not think differently about rights or expansively about rights. They will defer to the legal assessment about rights compatibility and therefore to the assessment that is just enough, more likely than not, to survive in the Supreme Court. We still have to realise the potential of the Scotland Act model in terms of thinking differently, thinking politically about rights. And I'll just give you a very quick example of where that might come into play. I say this fully aware that someone from the Scottish Government is sitting within throwing distance of me. And that example is that the right of prisoners to vote in the referendum. The convention, the European Convention on Human Rights, and the right on prisoners to vote does not extend, the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights tells us that it does not extend to referendums. It extends only to elections to the national legislature. Well, that's fine, and the legislation that saw through the independence referendum, that continued the ban on prisoners from voting in the independence referendum, survived a judicial challenge on the basis that that legislation had not been incompatible with convention rights. But a more expansive, a more bold, a more political view of human rights might have seen us take the opportunity in that vote to take a different approach to that which is currently enshrined by legislation and the Representation of the People's Act at the level of the UK, an opportunity perhaps that was missed. The second point I want to make about this is that I said that there is a danger that wealthy commercial interests can subvert the democratic process by delaying the implementation of legislation, even where the case itself might be hopeless or not far off it. One solution to this might be for a more proactive use by the Lord Advocate of his power to refer bills directly to the Supreme Court at the end of the legislative process. If an issue arises in legislation where it is inevitable, you know, when you pass legislation that affects insurers' interests, that affects the interests of a tobacco or smoking lobby, tobacco or alcohol lobby, where it's inevitable that wealthy challengers exist and will bring a challenge, then the Lord Advocate might refer a bill to the Supreme Court not to challenge the competence of the bill, but to ask the Supreme Court to defend its competence and therefore to avoid delays to the implementation of legislation. And then thirdly, to bring us back to Brexit, the most direct effect of Brexit for human rights in devolved areas will be to remove from the Scotland Act at least one limit to that legislative executive competence. That's the limit that relates to EU law. Now, it's unlikely, and I think there was a hint of this from the question in the last session, it's unlikely that this will have the same impact as it might have in relation to reserve matters. Because in relation to reserve matters, the power to disapply statutes that are incompatible with the European Charter on Fundamental Rights provides a stronger remedy than the remedy to have a declaration of incompatibility that puts the question back to Parliament but has no legal effect. It provides a stronger remedy to disapply a statute rather than to simply return the question to Parliament in relation to laws which are incompatible with the Charter. That will be lost in England, and therefore that power to have incompatible rights legislation set aside by the courts will be lost with it. But in Scotland, where both the Parliament and the Executive are more tightly constrained by the European Convention on Human Rights, it's really in the terrain of the Convention and not in EU law that most of the challenges to devolved legislation and devolved acts of the Executive have taken place. In fact, where on the few occasions that EU law has directly referred to, or rights under EU law has been directly referred to, the Supreme Court has given them fairly short shrift. So, for example, the Supreme Court said that there was no right to vote under EU law independent of any convention right. Similarly, when data protection issues were raised in relation to the named person scheme, concerns that information about children could be shared without their consent, not in accordance with law, the Supreme Court said that there was no need to address the data protection issues as a matter of EU law because they had already found that there was a breach in relation to the convention right. So EU law rights and obligations have not yet had much purchase in the judicial sphere in Scotland in relation to devolved matters. But what we don't know is to what extent the limits in EU law, the rights and obligations enshrined in EU law or conferred by EU law, we don't know to what extent they play out in the negotiations between the Scottish Government and the presiding officer's lawyers, in the negotiations between the Scottish Government and the UK Government lawyers, in those crucial weeks before the introduction of a bill, when amendments might be made to legislation in order to get approval by the presiding officer, in order to avoid a reference to the Supreme Court, in other words, to have the safe introduction and passage of legislation. We do know, because of a result of some of the research that's been conducted, that such amendments do often take place. We don't know, because of the veil of legal confidentiality, on what basis those amendments are made. But it seems a safe assumption, for example, that in relation to data protection concerns around the named person scheme, that concerns about data protection specific issues in EU law might have influenced the UK government, pardon me, the Scottish government, to rethink the initial safeguards for data protection in its legislation that was introduced, even if the new safeguards were subsequently and successfully challenged in the courts. So that's the first bullet point. The Scottish Parliament is supposed to be a parliament that is different, and that it's supposed to have us think differently about human rights. Think politically and more ambitiously about human rights. The second point, and I'll deal with the last three more quickly, I think. The second point is that notwithstanding the change to competence, there might be hope yet to salvage some of the benefits, the advantages of EU law that have been conferred on us in the arena of rights protection. And here what I have in mind is what we call the cross-pollination or the cross-fertilisation between the jurisprudence of the European Court of Justice and domestic law jurisprudence or the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights. In other words, some concepts that are protected at the level of EU law that have been defended in the jurisprudence of the Court of Justice might have contaminated, and I don't mean that in a pejorative sense, might have contaminated domestic law and convention rights jurisprudence. I'll give you some examples that will clarify what I mean by that. So, for example, in relation to the convention, the jurisprudence of the Strasbourg Court, which places the European Convention on Human Rights, its litigation in relation to the rights of those who have been detained by the police those rights have been enhanced by the European Convention on Human Rights with reference to the European Court of Justice, with reference to EU law. So, for example, where it is said that confessions made, where the threshold for the convention might be that confessions made without a lawyer might be inadmissible, a reliance on EU law and the jurisprudence of the court and directives under EU law has seen that be expanded beyond confessions to mere statements that might fall short of a concession. The content of the right is expanded at the level of the convention by its reliance on EU law. Similarly, in relation to the Named Persons Act, we've already seen or have already suggested that when the domestic courts, when the Supreme Court came to look at the data protection issues, they felt they didn't need to go to the European Charter on Fundamental Rights, they didn't need to go to EU directives because they had already been able to find sufficient protection, sufficient safeguards in the European Convention on Human Rights. That's at the level of the convention rights. At the level of domestic law, if not the content of EU law, then at least the tools which we have to protect rights might have seeped into our domestic jurisprudence. And again, I'll just speak very quickly about three of those. First of all, the test of proportionality. Traditionally, the UK courts do not know in judicial review a test of proportionality, that an action taken by the executive has had a disproportionate effect on a concerned individual or group. Rather, we apply a much higher threshold. In order to succeed at judicial review, you have to show that the decision was irrational, not disproportionate, irrational, so unreasonable that no reasonable decision maker could have come to the same decision. But under the influence of EU law, as well as the law relating to the Convention on Human Rights, the domestic courts have begun to grapple with and begun to transplant into domestic jurisprudence, i.e. in cases that don't merely concern rights under convention and EU law, have begun to graft into domestic law jurisprudence a test of proportionality. In other words, to take an example, the Supreme Court has suggested that even if citizenship is not a right conferred by the convention and is not a right conferred by EU law, it is nevertheless a right that is so fundamental that where citizenship is removed, it might be appropriate not to ask whether the government had acted so unreasonably that no reasonable body could have taken the same decision, but to ask whether the removal of that citizenship was disproportionate in pursuit of an aim, in the case of FAM, the aim of security, of prevention of terrorism. Secondly, as well as proportionality, substantive legitimate expectations, a doctrine well known to EU law, but not so well known to the domestic courts until they borrowed from EU law in a case called Coughlin versus North East Devonshire Council, in order to hold that where a care home made a promise to a severely disabled woman that she would have a home for life after the disruption of a move from one home to another, that promise was legally binding. It created a substantive, legitimate expectation that constrained the ability of the local authority to then remove her when it was no longer cost-effective to keep her in the home that they had promised for life. Again, through domestic law or through domestic law authorities, we now have authority for propositions that were previously known only in the law of the European Union. And so there might be, as Brexit approaches and as we move beyond Brexit, there might be opportunities to persuade the Supreme Court that some of these doctrines of proportionality, of substantive legitimate expectations, the more detailed procedural expectations that we might have, that some of these can be supplanted even further into domestic law, such as they would survive any severance with EU law. The third bullet point, and I'm aware, sorry, that I'm rattling through this quite quickly, but the third bullet point is that changes to devolved competence are about more than substance. They raise important questions about process too. Changing the devolved competence does not simply withdraw rights, it also raises important constitutional questions about how those changes can be taken about. In particular, we have the vexed question of legislative consent. So section 28.7 of the Scotland Act, section 28.7 of the Scotland Act, says that the UK Parliament retains, despite devolution, the UK Parliament retains its right to make law for Scotland, even in devolved areas. But in order to police that boundary, a political convention, the Sewell Convention, was established that said that the UK Parliament would not normally legislate in devolved areas without the consent of the Scottish Parliament. It would retain its right to legislate in those areas, but a political convention would say that it would not normally do so without the consent of the Parliament. And so Sewell would seem to be engaged, well, I should say, and that convention has since been expanded to cover not only UK legislation that is relative to or relates to devolved areas, but also legislation that amends the competence of the Parliament itself. The powers of the Parliament itself are in fact a reserved matter, but nevertheless changes to those powers, changes that affect the competence of the Scottish Parliament, are subject to legislative consent. And indeed, we are subject to legislative consent during the passage of the Scotland Act 2012 with some effect. So the Sewell Convention would seem to be engaged with regard to Brexit, both with regards to legislation that amends legislative competence, and here Sewell might, we've had the Secretary of State for Scotland say that Sewell would be engaged in relation to the Great Repeal Bill, and in relation to legislation in areas that, as it stands, should, as I said, devolve back to or revolve back to Holyrood rather than to Westminster. If the UK government decides that it intends that fisheries, agriculture, and environment is best dealt with at the level of the UK, then it should not assume to have those powers. It should assume that it requires the consent of the Scottish Parliament to take those, to return those powers to the level of the UK. Now, in the case of Miller versus Secretary of State for Brexit, the Supreme Court rejected a Scottish Government intervention to the effect that the Sewell Convention is engaged by the Article 50 Bill, and that this now had statutory force, given that the Sewell Convention is now somehow recognised in Section 2 of the Scotland Act. I just want to mention this briefly because it's relevant to Brexit and to the process of Brexit, what the Supreme Court did not decide in the Miller case. So, a criticism that has emerged of the Scottish Government has been that it wasted, this is a Daily Mail story, that it wasted £146,000, I think it was, of legal fees on an 11-0 defeat. The Supreme Court unanimously turning down, rejecting the intervention by the Parliament that Sewell is engaged, that the Scottish Parliament must grant its consent to the Brexit process. Well, there's two things that I want to say about this, and then three things about that, because I need three things. First of all, was this a resounding defeat for the Parliament? Was Nicola Sturgeon elbowing in to the process, which after all, EU is a reserved matter? First of all, the Scottish Government, it seems to me, were reluctant to intervene in this case. I don't think the Scottish Government intended to intervene in this case, lest it have unintended consequences for how Sewell might be engaged in other areas, such as the British Bill of Rights or the Great Repeal Bill, where more might be at stake. But following a decision of the High Court in Northern Ireland just before the Key Miller case, the High Court in Northern Ireland said two things. First of all, that in relation to changes to devolved competence in Northern Ireland, legislative consent was not needed. The UK Parliament could legislate without the consent of the Northern Irish Assembly. And secondly, that because the Sewell Convention is now in statute in Scotland, in Section 2 of the Scotland Act, that the position might be different in Scotland. That decision by the Supreme Court and by the High Court in Northern Ireland, it seems to me, forced the Scottish Government's hand. It could not leave the question where the Northern Irish High Court had left it, with the assumption that legislative consent is not necessary. The High Court of Northern Ireland said that this was a political rather than a legal rule. Well, the Supreme Court then said this, that, well, what it did not say, let me return to that point. What the Supreme Court did not say, they did not say that the Sewell Convention is not engaged, that the UK Parliament is not required to seek the consent of the Scottish Parliament to trigger Article 50, or with any knock-on effects for the Great Repeal Bill, or withdrawal from the Convention, or the British Bill of Rights. What they did say, however, is that this is a political, not a legal rule. Notwithstanding Section 2 of the Scotland Act, which recognises the existence of the Convention rather than puts the Convention on a statutory basis, this is a political rather than a legal rule. The convention might be engaged, but that's for political institutions to decide and negotiate between themselves in the political arena, not for the courts to police. And therefore, that removes an opportunity for lawyers to intervene in relation to the Sewell Convention in Section 2 of the Scotland Act in any future cases that revolve around the British Bill of Rights, the Great Repeal Bill, or withdrawal from the convention that might engage those rights. Now, I've got a wee bit to say about the British Bill of Rights, but I'll maybe leave that for questions because I just want to finish on a couple of points. Secondly, that by keeping the flame alive, the Supreme Court keeping the flame of Sewell alive, at least as a political, if not a legally enforceable rule. The Scottish Government, it seems to me, are now possessed of two bargaining chips regarding the UK and EU negotiations. The first, which seems to have been exercised today, it would have been helpful to know that last night, is the threat of a second independence referendum, that unless we can achieve something substantive, a different deal for Scotland, probably around the notion of access to the single market, then Scotland will be confronted with a choice of its preference between a hard Brexit or independence. Critics who say that Nicola Sturgeon should take IndyRef off the table ignore the fact that this is one of the most significant bargaining chips she has against the UK government, who largely seem to ignore the proposals put to them. Secondly, however, is the possibility that the Scottish Parliament might withhold consent to key aspects of Brexit, that where Brexit does engage the Sewell Convention, the Scottish Parliament might use the withholding of consent or the possibility or the threat to withhold consent in order to wring concessions. Now, you will not achieve single market membership through that. You won't achieve the big ticket items. But on process issues, such as, for example, supervision by the Scottish Parliament over the exercise of Henry VIII powers in relation to laws following the Great Repeal Bill, in those process issues, the power of withholding consent might be all the more forceful. We will refuse consent to the Great Repeal Bill unless the Scottish Parliament is given a greater influence or a greater input, a greater power of review over the way in which the UK government exercises those repeal powers. And then finally, I just want to finish where I started, which is the idea that devolution is supposed to encourage us, dares us to think differently, to think politically about human rights. Because human rights are devolved, and because Brexit and human rights debates cause us to re-examine both our approach to rights and, as Nicola Sturgeon said today, the sort of country that we want to be, we are once again, so soon after the Calman Smith Commissions, we are once again presented with an opportunity for those who seek to go beyond rights protections that we currently enjoy, to look both to broaden and to deepen those protections, to think again about the division of competences between Westminster and Holyrood, and not only to think about the substantive division of competences, but the rights protections and the rights agendas that we might push in an area, human rights, that by and large is a devolved area. So I just want to highlight three, funnily enough, points where this difference, the devolution of human rights, might make a difference. And I'm not going to touch on these two in too much detail. I'll only throw them up as maybe talking points. First of all, the Scottish Government has consulted on a rights-based approach to social security, in which principles of dignity and respect are promoted on the face of legislation and in a charter, which will give some bite to the idea that social security is not just a benefit, but a human right, a rights-based approach to social security that is markedly different from any approach that we might anticipate the UK government from taking. This, I think, gives us an opportunity for civil society, for groups like the Equalities and Human Rights Commission, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, the interested civil society groups or public interest groups. This gives them an opportunity, I think, to engage with those sorts of consultations, to engage in the parliamentary process that gives effect to this, and to shape what those principles are, what those principles mean, what the Charter on Dignity and Respect might contain and entail, and how it might be enforced. Now, I'll just suggest this, that courts are reluctant, certainly courts in the UK are reluctant, to give judgments that influence the way in which finite resources are spent. It seems to me unlikely that strong judicial protection of a right to social security will be welcomed or utilised by the courts. A heavy degree of deference would be used. But we might look at alternative mechanisms of enforcement. For example, enforcement of the Charter, enforcement of dignity and respect by the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman, in conjunction with the new Equalities and Human Rights Committee in the Parliament, might give real bite to dignity and respect in respect to social security. If we think, as lawyers tend to think, that rights are meaningless unless they can be argued by lawyers in a court, then weak powers of judicial review, such as those in the Human Rights Act, to declare legislation incompatible with social obligations of dignity and respect, might be one aspect of giving this judicial bite, but without inviting courts to make difficult judgments on the allocation of scarce resources. Secondly, in relation to equalities, the limited devolution of equalities, of competence inequalities to Scotland has been slightly enhanced by the Scotland Act 2016, which grants to the Scottish Parliament powers to legislate, competence to legislate on the makeup of public boards. It seems to me two things present themselves here as a result of Brexit. First of all, the Scottish Parliament has the power to set an example by legislating to its fullest effect in that area, and has indicated that it will legislate to its fullest effect in this area to create an obligation on public boards to have 50-50 balanced gender, a gender balance on public boards on a 50-50 basis. But secondly, and perhaps more significantly, because Brexit invites us to rethink the competence, the division of competences between Holyrood and Westminster, we can rethink some of those areas of equalities implementation that have been retained at Westminster and that were retained even following the Smith Commission. So, for example, the Labour Party, which seemed, from accounts of the Smith Commission, to have argued against devolution of employment law and regulation, seems to have come around to a slightly different view, and the Scottish Government might find some broader support in the Parliament for the devolution of employment law and regulation, such as to give even further effect to its more progressive, as we've said this, its more progressive views on equalities and human rights. And then thirdly, I'll just say this, that whatever the different approach is taken, will require an engaged and an active civil society, and will require forums through which an active and an engaged civil society can influence the protection of rights and equalities in the devolved sphere. The introduction of a new Equalities and Human Rights Committee, it seems to me, is a positive step by creating one such forum in which civil society can engage with the Parliament. But one of the unfulfilled promises of the Parliament is that committees themselves should have powers of initiation. Not buried under scrutiny of legislation, they should have the power to go out and to inform and to educate, to upskill civil society, to engage with civil society into how these areas can be, equalities and human rights can best be protected. And so one would hope that civil society will take the opportunity to engage with the Equalities and Human Rights Committee, and that the Equality and Human Rights Committee will take the opportunity to engage with civil society for a protection of equalities and human rights that is not just about strong powers of judicial review in the courts for those who can afford it, but which dares us to think differently, politically, more ambitiously, more boldly about what equalities and human rights might mean. If that seems a daunting prospect, then I'll finish just by saying that that was the very ambition of the Scottish Parliament and its creation, it seems to me, a noble one.